Hey, I'm Dave. Welcome to my shop. I'm Dave Plummer, a retired operating systems engineer from Microsoft, going back to the MS-DOS and Windows 95 days, and I've been coding in C and C++ for almost 40 years. Now that I'm finally getting good at it, I thought I'd take some time to show you a few of the cool and essential things I've learned along the way. Sometimes they'll be about performance, sometimes about style, and sometimes just ways to make your life a lot easier or just stay up to date. But either way, I'm confident that you'll discover something new that you can integrate into your own C and C++ development. All that, plus the story of the time that I changed a million lines of the Windows source code tree, all with a single check-in. Are you sitting comfortably? Then we'll begin. Hey, what's new? Exactly. New is the topic today because we'll be talking about the new operator and everything you always wanted to know but were afraid to ask, like bad allocation exceptions, implementing your own new, using the placement new, unique overloads per class, using different types of memory pools, and so on. And every now and then I'll throw in a tangentially related C++ quick tip like this. If you need the min or max of more than one value, I often see this done in code. Int x equals the min of a and then the min of b and then the min of c and d and then it backs up through the calls chain. That's seriously messy in my opinion, so instead write it like this using set notation. Int x equals the min and then in braces a, b, c, d, or whatever your list is. It's vastly more readable. Behind the scenes, it's using the initializer list class, and so it's still entirely type safe as well, unlike a macro might be, or even a function with a variable number of arguments. To get started, one story I want to tell soon is the story of the day that I personally changed about a million lines of the Windows code, literally. It really needs its own episode to be told properly, but I'll give you the highlights of it today. It takes place back in about 1994 on Microsoft campus. I had only been at Microsoft for about a year and had just moved over from the old COM32 team to join a newly formed NT Shell team. Now, this was a bit of a politically dicey hot potato because there already was a Windows NT Shell team, but they were working on a new, more better user interface for the future operating system known as Cairo. It was assumed that Win95 would be the end of the line for its interface and that Cairo would take over the desktop of the future with its suitably futuristic and powerful interface. But since we all know that didn't come to pass, what actually did happen? Well, it is a long story, and that's why it needs its own episode, so please be sure you're subscribed to the channel such that when I make that episode, you don't miss it when I release it. But, long story short, me and a few close friends ported the entire Windows 95 user interface, including the start menu, common dialogs, common controls, desktop, and so on, all over to Windows NT. That meant porting it from 8-bit ASCII text and the Windows 95 kernel over to 16-bit Unicode and the Windows NT kernel. As the RISC guy, for me it also meant porting it over to the 32-bit MIPS platform with all the attendant alignment concerns. But perhaps the biggest portion of the changes was to move from 8 to 16-bit characters. The problem is that before Unicode, programmers pretty much assumed that a character was synonymous with a byte or an 8-bit quantity, and it always would be. It could be signed or unsigned, but it had always been 8 bits. When we changed that assumption by making the character 16 bits, about a million lines of code had to be changed and then hand-reviewed. Anything that used a character, or a character pointer, or that used the size of operator was suspect. So was any memory allocation or string operation. Consider that in those days it was incredibly common to pass the byte size of a character buffer to an API that expects the number of characters. They used to mean the same thing, but not anymore. This required me to have the entire source code to all of Windows checked out onto my trusty old 100 MHz dual-core MIPS RISC box. The vast majority of our changes would be on the user side of things, focused primarily in the shell namespace, but it still mandated some kernel changes here and there as well. As you can see in my photo that I'm rocking dual full-height external SCSI hard drives just to accommodate the space needed to build all of Windows back then. They were probably Seagate 68-pin SCSI 2 drives, but I imagine they were at most 1 GB each. Somewhere I wrote down the statistics about how many lines actually did change, and between every instance of size of, character pointer, array size, memcopy, strcpy, malloc, calloc, and everything else impacted by the Unicode change, all together it amounted more than a million individual changes. And they were all checked out on my own dev machine using our source library management system known as Slime, which was so rudimentary back in the day that it didn't even support branching yet. Here's another quick tip. When you need the size of an array, but you need it in elements and not in bytes, as I mentioned earlier, you should create or use the array size macro. It's typically defined by dividing the overall byte size of the array by the byte size of an individual element, and that gives you the number of elements within. For the shell, I had to hand review every instance of size of in the code. I then changed them to an uppercase size of or uppercase array size as each situation called for. Rinse and repeat until all the lowercase size of's are eliminated, and you're done with that one step. When the time came to check these million or so changes in, you can imagine there's a certain amount of pucker factor. I don't think I assumed the build lab would even get through it the first time without a hitch, so needless to say, I hung around until I knew it all built, but it did before I left for the end of the day, so it was largely without incident. In the photo, you might have noticed that I'm posing along with a dollar bill on my corkboard. What's that about? Well, this was our first build of the shell that successfully compiled, but would it even run? And if so, how far would it make it before hurling digital chunks? Our dev lead Bob and I placed our bets. I bet we'd at least make it to see the desktop colors, but Bob thought it would crash early in the startup, long before that. Once it was done compiling, I nervously typed explore.exe into the command line and pressed enter. It was a full symbolic debug build, so much larger and slower than normal. And the hardware was all made 25 years ago too. It churned away with the old Barracuda disk heads thrashing like mad as it brought in page after page of freshly ported binary. And then, first light. The telltale aqua color of the Windows 95 desktop appeared. That was followed moments later by the desktop icons and the start button. Everything had the wrong icons and the text was entirely messed up, but it got far enough to show us that much, so Bob cheerfully handed me his dollar and I pinned it up on the corkboard for all to see and ask about for pretty much the rest of my entire career thereafter. This huge check-in was a success, and the only big mistake I made, in fact, was to automatically update any file history it found at the top of the file with a new entry that read something like November 24th, 1995, Davepl, ported to NT from Win95. The problem is that quite often this meant that my alias was now the only one that appeared in the file, and that was now true for hundreds if not thousands of Windows source files, and so I'd get a lot of desperate late night requests from interns and new hires looking for information on some obscure source file like the Tappy area code dialog. And people would think I was merely playing dumb when they claimed not to know anything about it. As noted, we had to inspect and correct every case where the memory allocation used new or malloc or any other memory API. If character strings are involved at all, you had to factor in the width of the new 16-bit characters. As a result, I got a lot of practice at reviewing and rewriting memory allocation calculations, and along the way, I saw a few bugs repeated from time to time, such as misuse and understanding of the new operator, and so the new operator will be the focus for today's episode. A lot of people think that new is basically the same as malloc, except that it runs a constructor of the object before returning it to you. And in essence, that is primarily what happens. There's a subtle and important difference, however, that if you don't know about, will cause your error path to never be taken. Instead, your program will just silently exit, and you won't even know why most of the time. Let's look at a hypothetical implementation of the new operator. Now, to be clear, when implementing new, you do not need to call the object constructor yourself. The compiler does so separately. All you need to worry about when writing your new is satisfying the memory allocation. Our example code is straightforward enough. Allocate the memory using malloc and then return the result. You could get the memory in any way you wanted, so for example, if you wanted to return new shared memory from a pool of some sort, you could overload the operator to do that sort of thing. I've done similar on the ESP32 to return SPI memory when desired, and we'll talk about that shortly. You can even overload it on a class-by-class basis so that some objects come from different pools or sources. When someone uses the new operator, they often tend to follow this pattern. They call new and they check for a null pointer coming back, just as they would if using malloc. And if new were actually implemented as shown in the sample, that would work. But it isn't, because new is specced by the standard to never return a null. If it can't satisfy the memory condition, it instead throws a bad allocation request. Checking for null doesn't work and will do nothing because when the C standard new operator can't allocate the memory it needs, it just throws an exception. That means you really have three options. You can either let those exceptions go unhandled and the system will just terminate your process and clean up the mess for you. Or your code can catch the exception and do something reasonable in response, like backing up the call stack to your last operation. Perhaps, though, you don't want to mess with exceptions at all and would prefer the allocator just return null when it fails to allocate, as so many people think it does anyway. If that's the case, you can simply pass the constant standard no throw to the new operator, which will cause it to return a null instead of throwing an exception. Here's some sample code that first allocates all the memory it can using new until an exception is thrown and the code catches it. In the second variation, it loops while allocating with the standard no-throw version of new. This second version returns a null when the allocation fails. If this looks a little bit new, let's consider how it works by looking at the signatures for the new operator, both with and without the second constant argument. Passing the no-throw constant serves to disambiguate the new operator so that the compiler calls a specialization with that no-throw constant. Now, what if you had an object in ROM, say, or even one copied from ROM or disk into RAM? If it's ready to go and you want to call its constructor and start using it, how do you construct a C++ object at a particular place in memory, or if it already exists? I suppose you could just manually invoke its constructor, but that seems rather bush league. Instead, we should use the barely understood placement new operator. When you call placement new, you provide the size and type just as normal, but you also specify the address in memory where the object lives. That memory must already be allocated, set up, and ready to go. The compiler then calls the constructor for you, but simply returns you the same pointer you gave it, which has the effect of constructing the object in place and returning its address as the this pointer to the new object ready to go. Thanks to C++ inheritance, it's a little more complicated than that. The actual order of operations is to first call the constructors for any virtual base classes. Next, it calls the constructors of non-virtual base classes. Then it calls the constructors of all class members, like your variables, before finally calling the constructor of the class itself. And they're all done in declarative order. Thus, you can see why you likely don't want to try to replicate all that behavior yourself. Let's pause to address a question you might have had by now, which is, why does the regular allocating new operator exist at all? Couldn't you define it to simply malloc the object and run placement new on that address? Yes, you could. But one benefit of the new operator is that it's totally type safe. You're required to cast and force the result of a malloc to match your type, but the return value from new actually is that type, so it's safer in that you don't coerce it or change it. Plus, another big benefit is that you can overload the new operator on a class-by-class basis, something that would be difficult or at least messy to accomplish with malloc. Let's have a look at how to do that. For this case, I'll use a real-world example. On the ESP32 microcontroller chip, there are two types of RAM. Regular RAM, which is directly connected to the CPU, and PSRAM, which is connected via the SPI bus. Now, regular RAM is much faster, but in much shorter supply. PSRAM is slower, but generally more plentiful if you have it. You had a similar situation on the old Amiga architecture with chip RAM and fast RAM. Thus, for certain types, you'd like them to come out of PSRAM and others should come out of regular RAM. The new and delete operators can be overloaded globally or per class. Let's say that we have a class called Audio Buffer, and we want it always to be loaded from PSRAM rather than regular RAM whenever anybody creates one. Even if the caller doesn't know anything about it, the special overloaded version for just that class will be called. Here you can see that the Audio Buffer class defines its own new and delete operators that call PSAlloc and PSFree instead of the regular malloc and free. Now, any creation of an Audio Buffer class object will automatically happen in PSRAM instead of regular RAM. It will also be freed properly, as we defined the delete operator for it as well. The user or caller of the class need not know anything about it. It just happens automatically because we've overloaded the operator for this one class. I massively increased the speed of a component once because it allocated tons of small buffers. It placed a significant load on the heap manager, and they were always used in scope or below, never passed backwards out. So I simply overloaded the new and delete operator for that class to allocate from the stack using alloc A instead of malloc. Now, alloc A allocates memory from the stack instead of the heap, and it's orders of magnitude faster than allocating heap memory because it simply has to advance the stack pointer register, which is, you know, almost free to do, versus searching and returning to you a free block of the appropriate size from the system heap. The only catch, of course, is that they go away at the end of the function since they're on the stack. The point, however, is that you can do some powerful things by overloading the new and delete operators appropriately and judiciously. Even if my return it off the stack will blow things up was not necessarily judicious. When it comes to arrays, there's a fair bit of responsibility placed on the programmer in C and C++. When you allocate an array of objects like foo pointer f equals new foo 100, the system allocates and constructs 100 foo objects for you, and all you get to show for it is the pointer to the first one. So when it comes time to free the memory, what if you just did this, delete f? Well, the problem is that that means you just want to delete the first element, since that's literally what you've said. But it probably corrupts the heap too, for all we know. The compiler has no way to know that you're holding on to a pointer to an array or where you got it from, so when deleting an array of objects, the onus is on you to do it properly by using the delete array version with the square brackets as follows. Delete, square brackets, f. Keep in mind this is true for integral types like integer as well, not just fancy classes with constructor hierarchies. Failing to properly indicate that you're deleting an array will likely implode at runtime no matter what the type is if you forget the brackets. This all begs one question. If the compiler must be told that it's even an array to begin with, how does it then know how many elements are in it when you go to free the ones that are arrays? And why can't it just use that information to know it's an array in the first place? Well, the answer is that if and only if it's an array, the compiler will have squirreled away the info it needs about how many elements there are. How and where the compiler stores that is proprietary and differs by compiler. It could be stored in memory along with the array itself, or it might be in an associative map somewhere else. But that's only present for arrays at all and not simple pointers to single objects, so telling the compiler that you're deleting an array is what clues it into the fact that it can now look up the size. Now that we're up to speed on the new operator and how it works relative to pointers and arrays, next time we'll look at how to remove them from your life entirely by replacing them with safe pointers, or more specifically, the new unique and shared pointers from the standard C library. That's all coming up next episode, so make sure you're subscribed so you don't miss it. And remember, if you learned anything along the way today, please drop me a like on the video so I get a rough gauge of how advanced to make these. I'll judge their success largely by your likes and subs, so please take a moment to like the video if you indeed found it useful or entertaining. Thanks for joining me out here in the shop today. In the meantime and in between time, I hope to see you next time, right here in Dave's Garage.